Good morning, everybody. Good to see you here this morning. This beautiful, beautiful day. Let's go to the Lord in prayer as we begin our lesson this morning. Our Father and our God, again, we give you thanks, God, for all your many, many blessings to us. God, we thank you for this beautiful day you've given us. We ask, God, this day that the Holy Ghost now will come and be our teacher as we worship you in your holy word today. We ask, Father, that this word will go down deep in our heart. Because, Father, this lesson today is something that affects all of us. So let us hear the word of the Lord in Jesus' name. And amen. James chapter 3, verse 1. Amen. I read this week. Now, this prophecy was given over 100 years ago. It said, a time will come when instead of shepherds feeding the sheep, the church will have clowns entertaining the goats. That's a hard prophecy. But I think we've seen that in part is coming to pass. Yeah. Folks, this is not a place of entertainment. Churches have been turned into entertainment centers. We're here to worship Almighty God, give Him the honor and the glory that He did. No, sir. No. Yeah. You know, it's just that I'm finding so many people that don't take church serious. I mean, the old saying is, this is a life and death matter right here. It is. Yeah. Yeah. As I said, this lesson today on the tongue, it hits every one of us. Yeah. And people are taking the tongue so, they don't seem like it makes any difference what they say. They just, you don't know. But we're going to see that it does make a difference. So in James chapter 3 and verse 1, James says, my brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. Now the word masters, as we said last time, this is teachers. And one of the reasons for that the teacher or the preacher, you have influence over other people. You know? And I've heard it said, well, he's a good man, but I know he wouldn't tell me wrong. Well, Paul told Timothy, he said, you know, the reason why they're deceiving other people is because they're deceived themselves. You know, and here's the thing about it. He said, we'll receive the greater judgment. If I'm deceiving you, I'm going to receive a lot harder judgment than you will. You know, but people don't say, oh, I've been saved. What I say don't make any difference. It makes all the difference in the world. We're going to see in a few minutes some words that Jesus said. And then verse 2 said, for in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same as the perfect man is able to bridle the whole body. If you can control your tongue, you can control your whole body. But we find today too many people are out of control. And it's coming from their tongue. You know. How many of you, if anybody ever saw this, I guess you'd call it a documentary, Appalachian Dawn, about the drug problem in Clay County, Kentucky. You know? Now we're talking about the tongue and what you say. There's a young girl that was heavily into drugs. One night she went to a drug house, and somebody beat her up, and she was in a closet, hiding, and she she screamed out, "God, where are you?" Well, it wasn't a short time later the police raided the place, and they found her in their closet, took her to jail. And there was a girl in the jail that sung continually, over and over, you know. And she was singing, I can't remember, my mind goes blank. But anyway, she finally said, "Why, Jesus died for me." And the point I'm trying to make is your tongue. She said, "The more I said it, the more I believed it." Yeah. Well, of course, she was born again that night. And sometime later, the pastor of the Full Gospel Church here in town came to see her. She came up to the window, big bruise on the side of the face, lip cut. He said, "What happened to you?" She said, "Well, a girl tried to steal my Bible last night, and I had to whip her." The point I'm trying to make is, here this girl had this strong desire for drugs, and once she was born again, her desire then changed for the Word of God. You see, that's what salvation is. You know, if there's not a change in a person's life, there's been no change, no salvation. See, to a Jew, the evidence of salvation is a change in behavior. And we've all seen people that have come to the altar and everything, and their life never changed. You know, it doesn't happen. But they were told, "Hey, you're going to heaven when you die." I'm telling you, that's dangerous. That's dangerous talk. I heard an interview many years ago, Evangelist Norval Hayes. Of course, he's already gone on now, but at that time he was in his late 80s, and he had successful businesses, had real good health and everything. And the interviewer said, "Well, what do you attribute all your success to?" He said, "I continually praise and thank God." See, what we say and how we worship makes all the difference, you know. You know, even the Apostle John, I believe it's in 3 John, I believe it is, he said, "I wish above all things you prosper, be in health, even as your soul prospers." The way your soul prospers has a lot to do with how you live in the health that you live in. And we're going to see that in deeper here a little later. But in verse 3 it said, "Behold, we put bits in the horse's mouth that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body." Now you just think about this. Here you put this little piece of metal in a horse's mouth, and you can turn that big animal which way you want it to go. Now what he's talking about now, that's this small little member in our mouth, how it's turning our bodies. You know, verse 4 said, "Behold, also the ship, though they be so great, are driven of fierce winds, yet they are turned about with a very small helm wheresoever the governor listeth." You know, a rudder on a ship, in comparing to the rest of the ship, it's nothing, is it, Carl? But that one little rudder, I don't care how big a ship it is, will turn that ship whichever way it wants to go, where the governor wants. Well, we are the governor of our ship, if you will. And this little thing right here, it's what's determining which way we're going to go. Verse 5 said, even so the tongue is a little member and boasts great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindles. You know, we don't think about a word sometimes. You know, we can say a few little things, but it can create a firestorm, if you will. How many times, even in our own life, how many times has somebody said something to you and it really, it just cuts you. Just cuts you to the bone, yeah. But hurting people hurt other people. You know, if you're talking to somebody or whatever, and they lash out at you, you know they've got something. There's something deeper than what they said to you that's going on. But here, in Proverbs 18 and 21, we all know this. We've heard this all of our life. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. In other words, he's saying here, whatever you say, you're going to eat it. And I will love it. But notice, as I tell you so many times, most of the time when you hear somebody quoting this verse, they'll always say life and death. No, God wrote it the way it was. We speak death far more than we speak anything about life. I mean, you don't hear anybody speaking anything, very few if any, speaking life. But everybody that I hear is speaking death. Now this thing's killing me. I died of life and all that. You know where I'm going with that. But I feel the Spirit reveal something to me this week that I had never thought of. Have you ever thought of these people, and you hear them all the time, some people are worse than others talking like that. Have you ever noticed they always have another pain? They always have something, another physical problem going on in their life. It's all coming from the tongue. Yeah. You know. But, you know, most of these people would tell you, well, there's nothing to that. It don't make no difference what you say. You know? But it does. You know? Yeah. You know, when we're in the school, dead, sticks and stone may break my bone, but words will never hurt me. And they hurt you a whole lot worse and a lot longer than the sticks and the stones. Yeah. I mean, you can change somebody's life by what you say to them. The more that you will speak the word of God, the better off you're going to be. Anytime. Yeah. I mean, well, that's more on down in the lesson. We'll get into that in just a few minutes. Verse 6 said, the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body, and setteth on fire the course of nature, and is set on fire of hell. That's strong words. I mean, what you say, Jesus said, we may see it in a minute, what Jesus said, comes from in here. What comes out of your mouth comes out of your heart. It's already down in you. Let's go first to Matthew 15 and 11. This is what I was talking about. Jesus saying, not that which goeth into the mouth defileth the man, but that which cometh out of the mouth, this defileth the man. Now let's go to Revelation 21:27. It said, and there shall no wise, he's talking about in heaven, there shall no wise enter into it anything that defileth, neither whatsoever worketh abomination or maketh a lie, but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life. In other words, what he's saying here, basically, the things that comes out of your tongue is going to be something that will keep you from the kingdom of God. But back to Proverbs 19. Proverbs 19 and verse 5. It says, a false witness shall not be unpunished, and he that speaketh lies shall not escape. Go down to verse 9. A false witness shall not be unpunished, and he that speaketh lies shall perish. And when you go to Revelation 21 and 8, you'll find that all liars have their part in the lake of fire. In today's society, it's hard to find somebody that'll tell you the truth. I tell you, some of the biggest liars we have are in our leadership and our government. They're telling people all this, telling everybody how good everything is today, and people can't hardly afford to get enough food to eat. All they're after is your vote. They want to stay in power. But what they don't realize right now, they're going to give an account to you. Verse 7 said, for every kind of beast and of birds and of the servants and of things in the sea is tamed and hath been tamed of mankind. But the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil full of deadly poison. Yeah, and that's true. I mean, in the circus, they'll have lions tamed. There's tigers, some of the fiercest animals are going. Elephants, big elephants are having things. But they can't tame this little thing in the mouth called the tongue. That's terrible. But, like you said a minute ago, we have been programmed this way. From the time we were able to talk ourselves, we're brought up that way. You know, that's the way our parents were brought up. You know. Can't keep doing the same thing and get a different result. Something's got to change. And when I was given this revelation of the tongue, and I was give credit to the late Charles Capps. This is one thing that he always taught on, was the tongue. What you say. You know, he was a farmer in Arkansas, and he said that, you know, he would speak, he would curse his own crop. Well, these soybeans and they'll never make nothing. You know, this cotton, it ain't gonna make nothing. And he said, sure enough, it didn't. He said, until I started speaking blessings over my crops, he said, I didn't grow anything. Yeah. And that's what a lot of people do. You know, they say, well, I think I'll go to church this morning, but I know ain't nothing going to happen up there. Well, they done cursed the service. For them, at least. You know. My life, I say it's the same in every one of them. How many times have you said something and there's a check right here? No. But see, this is what I've always told you. You know, you learn from your mistakes. Tongue is like a gun. Once you pull that trigger, you're not going to get that bullet back. I mean, as I said, so this hits us all. We're all guilty of this. You know, but it's never too late to change. This is something, I don't care what it is. You can never fix a problem until you admit you've got the problem. You know, that's what Solomon said. Solomon said that God's in heaven and we're on the earth, so let your words be few. Therewith bless we God, even the Father, therewith curse we men which are made after the similitude of God. In other words, we are made in the image of God, but yet we're cursing our brethren, our sisters. That word curse in the Greek means to wish evil against a person or a thing. How many times have you may have done it, or you've heard somebody, all right, what they're going through is good enough for them. You're cursing that person. Yeah. You need to speak a blessing on that person. What we're supposed to do. Verse 10 said, out of the same mouth proceed blessings and curses. My brethren, these things ought not so to be. Look, if you will, at Matthew 12:36. Matthew 12:36-7. This is Jesus speaking here. He said, but I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give an account thereof in the day of judgment. For by your words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. You go, whatever I'm saying, one day I'm going to meet you again. Give an account for it. But, as I said before, people don't, they don't believe that. You know, I even heard somebody say that they were in a Sunday school class and they read that verse, and one person said, well, I don't believe that'll happen. Well, Jesus said it will. But I tell you one thing. There's some people I hope I'm not behind in the judgment, because it's going to be a long time. But you know, I mean, you've heard me say this before. You know, some people, their biggest problem's right under their nose. It's their mouth. And I said before, there's too many people got diarrhea of the mouth. They just go on. You know, there's some people you don't talk to, you just listen. Yeah. But what, just like James stated, once we learn to control our own tongue, then we control our whole body. Now he's asking some questions here in verse 11. He said, do the fountains send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? Okay. You know, the only way you get warm water out of a faucet, you've got to mix cold and hot. And so the mouth, we can't spew forth blessings and cursings at the same time. It just don't happen. No. Verse 12 said, can the fig tree, my brethren, bear olive berries, or either vines, figs? So can no fountain both yield salt water and flesh. As I said a minute ago, everything will produce after its own kind. Yeah. A lot of people that have problems and everything going on, if you want to find out what's going on in their life, just keep your eyes open and your mouth shut and your ears open and you'll hear. Just listen to them talk for just a little while and you will find out why they're having the problems they're having. This thing on the tongue, nobody wants to deal with that. But it is one of the best teachings in the book of James, in my opinion. Because once you control that, then you know you can control everything else that you do. Our time's up. He goes on to another subject here in the 13th verse. So we'll pick up on verse 13, God willing, next week.